ligando pro Frederico?
I would like to introduce Francisco Sinesta. So Francisco has a last minute constraint, so he didn't succeed to join us. And so Francisco will he has a share at Ensam on Hybrid Digital Twin. And he will give you a talk on learning physics from data. So the floor is yours, Paco.
Thank you. So I will present my talk. I will try to advance a little bit faster or finish maybe a little bit early. So the title is Learning Physics from Data, and obviously from the perspective of an engineer. So I will try to follow the next plan. I will start by reducing data. After, I will move to modeling the reduced data. And if we have a little bit of time at the end, I will speak about the reduction of the model itself. This is the plan of my presentation. And there is Frederick that has all the presentation in his computer. So I start with the first point that concerns data reduction. And data reduction is something that is very, very close to something very important in physics, that is related to the intrinsic dimensionality of manifolds. I will try to focus on this concept, and for that, I will move from linear to nonlinear dimensionality reduction. So I just start with something. Imagine a system in which you have different parameters, mu1, mu2, mu3, and for some of the values of these parameters, you collect the outputs, in this case only two, O1 and O2. And you perform this for capital D data. Is the output for different choices of the inputs. And imagine for a while that you have the points that appears in the diagram on the left. You have all these points, and you could consider that these points are in a two-dimensional manifold, but in fact, you have only one, because you can understand that all these points are in a straight line. So finally, even if you have two outputs, finally there is one that is a function of the other. And even if you are representing the points in a 2D space, finally you have only one dimension, that in this case is the intrinsic dimensionality of your manifold. So this is the idea of PCA, principal component analysis, in which we are looking for a rotation of the axis. We are moving from the blue one to the red one. And when we are moving the axis, you can see that all the data points are on one of the coordinate axes. There is nothing in the other, and this reveals that finally your problem is one-dimensional. So this is the geometrical view of the PCA. Now we can move to a more complex situation in which you have these data points. You start to rotate the axis like PCA, and for any of the rotations, the data points are one of the new coordinate axes. So you could conclude that apparently the dimensionality of your manifold is 2. But in fact, this is not 2. It's simply that your manifold is nonlinear. And the data, the outputs, U2, O1, are functions, one of the other, and you can parameterize by this curvilinear coordinate, small c, and if you are unwrapping this manifold, you can see that all these points are in a 1D manifold. So we can conclude that when a model or the manifold is linear, you can apply linear model order reduction, like PCA, by this technique file, as soon as your manifold is nonlinear. And in that case, you need to use more sophisticated nonlinear dimensionality reduction techniques, like the locally linear embedding, LLE, the kernel-based PCA, a local PCA, or the TSNA. There are many others, but you need to apply this in order to extract the intrinsic one approximation to the intrinsic dimensionality as soon as the manifold is nonlinear. So the question is always the same. I have data. This data is in an unmanifold. You should identify that the dimensionality of this manifold is much smaller than the space in which you are representing the data. You would like to extract that dimensionality in this case is 2, and you would like to map the data from the initial space to the target space that is the reduced dimensionality 1, that is on the right. And we need techniques in order to perform this, because in many engineering problems, it's very important to reduce the data and to know the dimensionality of the real physics or the dimensionality of the manifold in which the solution is living. One example concerns, for example, microstructures. You take a photo. There are many pixels. Imagine that you have capital N pixels, and you agree with me that each one of these photos is a point in a space of dimension capital N, and that a photo is no more than reporting in each one of the coordinate axes the gray scale, for example. So you can see one image is one point. And if you repeat this for many, many images, finally you have many, many points. Each one of them is representing one image. And the projection in the coordinate axis reveals the gray scale of each one of the pixels in the image. And now, as soon as each one of these data to explore, if the dimensionality is in reality capital N, if these points are located on a slow manifold. And this is very important in order, for example, to represent data, to visualize data, to interpolate data, or to create models from data. So one of the techniques that I could explain only in one slide is the locally linear embedding LLE that takes all these points that are living in a space of dimension capital N. And now you can consider, you don't know which is the dimensionality of the manifold if it exists, And the idea is to capture, to extract, and to represent these data points in a reduced manifold if it exists. And for that, I take each of the points, for example, the red one, and I take all the closest neighbors of this point, the one in violet, that are the closest to the red point. And now we can assume that if the violet points are very, very close to the red one, we are in the tangent space, and we could assume that we are locally linear. The manifold is non-linear, but around the red point, the red with the violet, we are in a locally linear tangent space. And this means that the point, the red point, could be written as a linear combination of the neighbor data points. So we are making this sum on all the data points G in the vicinity of I. And now the question is, what is the value of this W, the weights that depends on the distance between the red and the violets? And for that, we construct the functional capital F that is no more than the sum of the difference to the square of xi minus its linear representation, its locally linear representation. So we would like to compute W as in order to represent the point xi. And for that, we minimize this functional and we obtain all the weights W, I, G. As soon as you capture this information, now you can assume that in order to take this locally linear manifold and put it in the target space that is in the bottom on the right, in which there are only a small n instead of capital N dimensions, you can put your red point, and after you can distribute the violet by writing that yi can be represented linearly with the yg by using exactly the same weights, because linear transformations don't modify the weights. And now we are looking for precisely the reduced coordinates yi and yg. And for that, we define the new functional g, and we try to minimize the distance between yi and its linear, locally linear representation by assuming that W now is known and we are looking for the Y coordinates. And by minimizing this, you can obtain the mapping, or you can map each data point in the space of dimension capital N into a point in the reduced space of dimension small n. And so implementing this is few lines, and it's very useful because you can extract an approximation to the intrinsic dimensionality, and at the same time you can obtain a representation of the slow manifold that is embedded in the original space. If we apply this for the microstructures, we can see that finally three coordinates are almost sufficient, and you can see even that the first two are very important. The third one is almost nothing because the coordinate is minus one, minus one, minus one, minus one. So this means but yi1 and yi2. And this is the different points that represent the different snapshots. And now in this space, we can compute distance and we can interpolate safely, because even if the manifold is nonlinear, now is linearly represented, and this means that we can interpolate because the vicinity in the sense of any metric is well ensured. So when we apply this, for example, in an application case, these are levers, and we would like to extract how many parameters define the shape of the lever of any human being. This is 1,000 levers that were transferred or provided by IRCAD in France, that is the hospital. As soon as we obtain these levers, we put each of one in a box, and in order to understand or to define the shape, we take the distance between each one of the pixels in this box to the surface of the lever. And you can agree with me that if there are capital N pixels or voxels in your cube, now each lever is a point in a space of dimension capital N, in which the projection of each point in one axis refers to the distance, to the Euclidean distance between the voxel and the surface of the lever. And after you can perform the LLE, and you can obtain that finally the lever or the shape of the lever could be represented by four parameters, only four, and when we are moving in this space in the slow manifold by changing the four coordinates, you obtain different deformations of this geometry, and the only thing that I can ensure the room in which you are is a particular position of these four buttons. Is one point in a space of dimension four, and not all the geometrical parameters, for example, related to a CAD description of the lever. So finally, we reduce, and we can compute and quantify the shape of an object, for example, by putting it in a box, by computing the distance of each voxel to the surface, applying the LLE and identifying that there are only four significant parameters. And so this means that we reduce from a space of dimension, I don't know, 1,000,000, the number of voxels, to a space of dimension four. And this is absolutely important if you are interested in taking decisions, if you are interested in visualizing, if you are interested in interpolating behaviors, or you are interested in creating models. Now we apply exactly the same thing in another example. Now we are not speaking about cars. We are speaking about levers. We are speaking about cars. And we put each one of the cars into a box, and we are solving the Navier-Stokes equation, and in each node of this mesh, we are extracting velocity and pressure fields. And now you agree with me that each aerodynamic simulation Each aerodynamic analysis is no more than a point in a very high dimensional space of dimension capital N. So now you take plenty of cars, you repeat, and you obtain that each aerodynamic solution is a point in a space of dimension capital N, millions, in fact. And now you apply your LLE, and from an energetic point of view, in a particular metric, finally, there are almost two nodes, two coordinates that could represent the aerodynamic field around the car. And this is incredible, because something that you expect to be very, very rich, in fact, is not so rich. Each point, even when you have millions of coordinates, when you are changing the shape of the car, and taking real cars, this is very important, finally, each solution could be represented in a small manifold of dimension 2. And we performed this analysis for hundreds of cars, creating the mesh, putting in a box, simulating the Navier-Stokes equation in laminar and turbulent flow, and each one is a point in a space that applying the LLE finally of these cars in a space of dimension 2, and you can see they group in this vertical line and this diagonal line. So it's even less than 2, but 2 is enough. Obviously, if we take one of the points that I analyze, I can represent three lines around the car that I analyze. And now the fact that the solution is good when I'm in a point that I integrate in my model is reasonable. But there is something that is incredible. One day in the parking of the university, I found a car that I never simulated in my life. Never. So I take a photo. With the photo, I analyze the point in the manifold. I extract that the point is this red star. I take the neighbors because I would like to proceed in the locally linear interpolation. And I interpolate the velocity and pressure fields linearly because we are in the linear, locally linear tangent space. And we represent the interpolated fields. And you can see that the interpolated in real-time fields agree perfectly with the shape of the new car. And more than this, by interpolating the lift and the drag, and by computing this car by using CFD, the error that we compute by using this manifold learning was lower than 2%. That is a very good news, because this now could be a tool in the pre-design in which one artist is modifying the shape of the car, and in real time, he obtained the lift and the drag and take the associated decisions. So in order to make designs in real time, it's not necessary that you solve Navier-Stokes equation. The only thing that you need is to interpolate safely the solutions of the closest neighbors on the manifold. So this is a video, but if we have not too many time, I will move to the next point. And obviously, you are interested in the video you have in my PowerPoint presentation. The next question consists in general, we are using always the Euclidean metrics. Euclidean metrics is not the best one. For example, when you are comparing shapes or we are comparing topologies. In this example, you have three trees. Finally, it's impossible to know in what sense they are close. They are three trees, I'm sure. But in what sense they are close? What kind of resemblance between them? How many parameters define a tree? And finally, what is the adequate metrics in order to compare trees or to compare a tree and a car? So finally, one thing is clear: by taking a photo and comparing the photos pixel to pixel, using the Frobenius norm, for example, is not enough, because the difference between two photos of two trees is very, very large. So finally, we have a problem with the most appropriate metrics when we are comparing things that in which the Euclidean metrics is not good. And for that, one possibility consists in order to extract information and knowledge from time series, consists in using topological data analysis. I will try to explain in a couple of just to apply in some examples. Imagine that you have this time series in which you have many points, and now we try first pairing min max neighbor points. For example, the two that are in the red squares, the two that are in the green squares, or the two that are in the blue squares. Obviously, there is a point that is not paired because there are the name of maximums and minimums is not the same, but this is irrelevant. The result is the same. And after you can move from this space, something that we call, or that is called, persistence diagram. And persistence diagram is, there is one couple, that you, there is one pair that is start at 7 the mix, the mean, and 9 the max. And we put this in this representation, the mean and the max, 7, 9. After we have 9, 10, you move to this diagram and you represent 9, 10. And finally, 11, 14, you have a point in 11, 14. This is another representation in which you are representing only pairs, neighbor pairs of min and max. And obviously, as the max is greater than the mean, the points are in the upper B sector and there is nothing. And we call this birth and death because the death occurs in general after the birth. So you have these points, and now you can move from the persistence diagram to the lifetime diagram. We change the coordinates, and this diagonal is now the horizontal axis, and this coordinate, the lifetime, is no more than the distance, the vertical distance between the points in the persistence diagram to the diagonal. So we have one that is 2, 1, and 3, that are the life of the different events. And now, to finish, take each one of these points, we associate a kind of density by using a Gaussian kernel, and after, you can obtain a kind of pixelized image, and now the value in each pixel is no more than the density integrated in the corresponding pixel, and like this, you can represent finally a time series as an image, and this is the good news. This is a point in a vector space, and now you can start to compare, to visualize, to interpolate, or to create models related to the time series if you treat not the particular value of each time, but more the topology of the image. So for example, in engineering, sometimes we have plenty of rugged surfaces in composites. We had 16 families of composites or materials, and more than 1,000 realizations of these 16 families of surfaces. And we would like to classify all the ones that are coming from the first family, second, third, fourth, etc. And making this by taking the data, the blue data, is very complex, but if you consider the topological description of this time series, and as soon as you obtain the persistent images, you make a clustering by using 16 families, you can see that the predicted and the real is the diagonal. More than 1,000 of surfaces were perfectly classified with all. Powerful, and that reveals that the Euclidean matrix in general is not the best choice, and that in order to compare, we need to take into account the right parameter in order, and the topological data analysis is one possibility. Another example in human models, you have drivers. This is very important for the driving assistant. And you know that if you could measure the vibrations of your head, you could detect if you are tense, relaxed, if you are tired, or you are nervous. And this is very important in order to adapt or to assist the driver depending on his state. And for that, in the labs, they are putting exciting the floor of this seat. They are putting people and they are measuring with a laser the movement of the head. And finally, you have very complex time series that now, by using the persistent diagram, persistent image, and you classify the behaviors, you can obtain that finally a particular behavior is given by this persistent image, and you can obtain an score higher than 96%. This is the first time that we obtained this score, and obviously was because instead of looking for the details of the signal, we are looking for the topology. Okay, and this could be used, for example, in component behavior. You have faults, you have nominal behavior, and here is very difficult to compare all these kind of things. When you are speaking about topology, this is the persistent images, this is the persistent, the persistent diagram, and this in the bottom, the persistent images, you can see when it's nominal, the signature is the same. You have a tree, the signature is the same. And when you have something that is not a tree, something in this case that is a fault, you have a different signature in the topological space. You can apply this also to images. I have no time to move on, but from an image, you can obtain the persistence image. And from that, many materials with a rich microstructure is very difficult to define exactly what is a foam or what is a honeycomb. Finally, it's very easy to determine the different and compare the different topologies and morphologies by using this persistent image that is based on the topology data. This is for the honeycomb barriers in elastoplasticity. You can separate the form structure in which you have a very localized signal in the persistent image because it's the regular cell when you have buckling. As soon as you are in the buckling phase, you have a persistent image that is very close and reveals buckling, and you have an indicator to move from elasticity, buckling, and post-compression. Finally, I would like to discuss with you how to extract knowledge from all this data. And I will apply this in a very easy problem. We consider, for example, this beam, and we consider the Euler critical load. You know, P is proportional to the width, to the height, and to the length of the beam taking this relation. So taking data is very easy. You can measure H, you can measure B, you can measure L, and you can measure P. And the question is, with this information, could I infer the equation? And I will proceed in two parts. The first one is, imagine that finally, I measure only H, and I measure only L. But we never measure B, never. So you measure H, you measure L, you measure B, but you ignore that B exists. When you represent the result, you have something that is exotic in the sense. If the color is the value of the critical load, you can see that for the same value of L and H, you can obtain different P. It's normal. It's normal because there are different values of B. But you ignore that B exists. And so finally, you obtain fluctuations. And the main question is the problem stochastic? Or simply, there is a hiding internal variable that you never measure, but is this variable that explains the fluctuations. So in order to solve this question, if we decide that we are looking for a deterministic model, in that case, you apply again LLE or PPCA, and you ask, please, I'm looking for the intrinsic dimension. And now it's clear. You need another coordinate in order to avoid the fluctuations. This is very classical. This is not new. And the good news is we can now map the data in 2D in another extra dimension. And if we decide to each one of these data to put the color of B, even if we never measure it, now the colors appear graded, and this means there is a hidden value that you never measure, and probably in this new coordinate that is related to the new variable is the one that is removing the fluctuations, and all the data will be perfectly stratified. So we cannot discover the nature of the variable, but we can see that there is something in my physics that is ignored by my data. And like this, I could think about what is the new data that I need, because the one that I introduce is not enough. Another case, we consider the same problem, but please, imagine for a while that the Euler critical load does not depend on B. It depends only on H and on L, not in B. Obviously, this is absolutely wrong. But for a while, we imagine a physics like this. And now we decide to measure H, L, and B. Even if B is irrelevant. It's irrelevant, but I measure B. What is the question? We have three data. And the P, that is the first one. And I ask to the QPCA, please, what is your intrinsic dimension? And the intrinsic is, oh my God, 2 is enough. Because I can put all the data in a manifold of dimension 2. So this means that even if I introduce 3 data, only 2 is relevant. And now, if each one of these data points, I use the color related to B, we can see that everything is mixed. There is not correlation, and this indicates that for this physics, the beam width seems useless. If we represent with respect to the height or with respect to the length, there is a perfect correlation, linear and inverse, that indicate that both parameters are useful. And like this, even we can try to put this in a series, put all the parameters using a Newton method and try to correlate the values that you identify as pertinent with the output, and by using a technique you can discover the exponents, and finally you are rediscovering, it's ridiculous in this case, but you can rediscover many equations from the data, even if this is not necessary, of course, in this case, but it could be interesting in others. So to finish in 5 minutes, I would like to discuss a little bit about how to use now this data that has been reduced in order to create models. In the past millennium, we use data, we use physics, we use models, we use math, and we obtain data. Data in the inputs, data in the outputs. The unknown was the data. Now, if you have plenty of data concerning the inputs and the outputs, maybe by using artificial intelligence, we could try to infer the model. So this is the only thing. It's exactly the same framework. In the past, the data model was known, and we look for the output data. Now in the training, data as input and data as output are known, and we are looking for the model. So this is more or less the sketch of the just discussion. There are many technologies. There is no time to move in this direction. And I introduce here some of them that runs very well, even in real time, and even when you have few data, few. And that is not secret. If you have few data, if you need to train or to learn from few data, you need to incorporate the knowledge coming from physics. And for that, and this is the last part of my talk, only 3 minutes, I'm speaking a little bit on the thermodynamically consistent machine learning. But this is quite a standard, the state of a system change in time, and we can identify a conservation part by this Hamiltonian with the gradient of the internal energy, and this dissipative part in which you have a matrix that is positive definite, and you have the gradient on the entropy. And now it's clear, the gradient of the energy is related to the state as well as the gradient on the entropy. And now as soon as we have many states and many times, we can compute the rate of change. And with the rate of change of the state and the state itself, I would like to compute the physics, the L and the M, the L antisymmetric, the M symmetric, and like this I'm sure that I'm conserving energy and producing entropy. And we put all this in the computer, in the past L and M is known, and we compute the evolution of the system. Now the evolution of the system is known, and I will compute the simplest model thermodynamically consistent. And for that, we can run this, and we can obtain, this is the data, we take the data, we learn the Navier-Stokes equation in a reduced system without knowing nothing on the Navier-Stokes, but we are creating the matrix related to the Hamiltonian and the matrix related to the dissipation. And for that, again, to reduce the model, we are using LLE, and we are using the topological data analysis as a filter to reduce the noise. And with this, we compute the dissipation, the Hamiltonian, and the matrices that are related to the gradient of energy, gradient of entropy, and now you can see my predictions with respect to the measurements are almost in perfect agreement. To prove this, this is a problem that I'm solving. Real time, sorry, this one in which we can even by the fluctuation, simulate the position of the fluid and identify the kind of fluid. Is an oil, is water, is chocolate, you can even in real time simulate, because you learn your physics, this system is stable because you have M, and you keep energy constant because you compute the right L. And now you can simulate in real time, you agree perfectly in physics, but you are learning thermodynamics. You are not making only data or machine learning, you are learning the physics because you are absolutely consistent with thermodynamics. And the last slide, obviously, today we are using autoencoders. Why an autoencoder? Because we have a very large input, we have a very large output that is the state of your system. But as discussed at the beginning, there are few latent variables. This is the dimension of the small or slow manifold. And the idea is to extract this by using neural network. The idea is I would like to reduce this state and to come back to the same. And the size of this layer is an approximation to the intrinsic dimension of your slow manifold. So this is classical. We are using manifold learning. People working in deep learning prefers autoencoder. Encoding, decoding, and the size of this layer reveals, inform about the quantity of data that you cannot lose, because if not, you are lost in physics. And in our case, we propose to make the same, encoding, decoding, but in order to create the physics in the reduced level, in the slow manifold, we are using a structure preserving neural networks, and inside there is generic. And we are discovering the reduced counterpart of the Hamiltonian and the dissipation matrices. We are learning the physics in the reduced space, and this is very, very close to knowledge, because in a system you have plenty of atoms, but knowledge is pressure, volume, and temperature. So finally, you are removing the details, but you need, when you remove the details, keep the energy constant and produce entropy. So this is the main idea that we are using in order to create a thermodynamical counterpart of the reduced model. And now, as soon as this runs, we can apply this in order to discover other behaviors. You have an hyperelastic material, but we can discover the correction in the entropy. In this case, when you are using an hyperelastic with dissipation, there is no necessity of correcting the energy. This term was zero, but obviously we compute a correction of M, and we could represent with data, we can update, correct, or enrich a standard hyperelastic material in order to take into account dissipation. So finally, we write that the reality is a model that is not perfect, plus a correction, but this correction must be thermodynamically consistent, and we apply this for these materials in plasticity, etc. So I prefer, there are few slides more, but are not important for the discussion. I prefer to stop here. It's time, in case of you have few questions. If not, I'm really sorry. I'm not with you because I have a very important familiar issue, and I'm flying from France to Spain 2 times per week. But if you have questions, please don't hesitate to send me an email, and I could share with you papers, my slides, videos, or having a discussion with you if you have more questions. We have no time now to respond all the questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Francisco. Thank you, Francisco. As usual, you have saturated the microphone. question? I will... what is your question? I will...
So I was asking myself, I understand and I totally agree with you that we need to integrate thermodynamics inside neural networks. My question was, have you tried to see how the networks, once it learned from thermodynamics, it generalized the data? Meaning, let's say that you made the network learn inside a certain range, and then you make the network do new prediction in a completely different range. For example, if you're talking about the how it behaves.
Yeah.
I'm working as well on the same for considering modeling, and I would ask, I would like to know if you have tried it and what is the result that you got.
Yes, we can send some papers in which we discuss this. The question is very, very nice. When we learn the thermodynamical reduced model, we can after, obviously, we are not only reproduce the data that we use for the model, we can reproduce other experiments and prove that we can keep the energy and we can produce entropy. This is absolutely good. And if we remove the thermodynamical layer, the problem is the model that I learn is a good model, point to point, but it's not stable. And if it's not stable, this means that the model explodes. So it's incredible because we can see that if we learn a reduced model in the thermodynamics, we obtain a stable integrator that is more or less symplectic. We need to prove this. But if you don't enforce this thermodynamical framework, the solution explodes in less than 1 second. It's absolutely incredible.
Okay. I love the enthusiasm of Paco. You not have only to preserve the energy, but all the moment map. You could have other invariants in your physical problem. There is not only energy preservation. You could have other invariants. Could you hear us? No?
Frederick, I don't. The micro is not very good. Can you approach the micro and put the question again, or
you use invariants of energy?
It's more easy to respond by mail.
You use invariants of energy, but could we use other invariants?
I don't use the value of the energy. I use only the states, and I'm identifying all the matrix with all the properties. We are writing the internal energy as a matrix that depends on the state, the same for the gradient of the entropy with the degeneracy condition, because the matrices must verify some properties. And now we are identifying everything. We are identifying L, A, M, B, and so we are applying this in a Hamiltonian systems, obviously, and this is perfect. We are applying this in dissipative systems, and we are applying this to different levels of different physics. Maybe I don't respond to the question because it's very difficult for me. The sound is not good. Okay. But if you have a precise question, don't hesitate to send me an email, please.
Okay. So thank you, Paco.
Thank you very much.
Okay. See you soon.
Thank
Bye.
You.
Thank you.